this is kind of a catch-up video really, because I have done various top fives, top tens and what have you, but the channel is over 2 years old now, and even though I keep saying watch the backlist, a lot of you naughty people don't, and some of the early videos in terms of picture quality are a bit ropey. So I decided to do a top 25 SF novels. I think there's one or two collections of short stories in here of the 21st century. A lot of these books, I think I've covered all these books before, but because I've done a few things recently on where SF is now, the rising tide where people seem to be dissatisfied with what's happening in SF, the way that fantasy is predominating, and people are struggling to find new things to read, I thought I'd look back at the books which were I expanding my little pocket guide 100 must read science fiction novels to 200 books, oh, if that would happen. But of course it keeps selling just enough for ANC Black Bloomsbury to keep it in print, because of course to expand it they'd have to give me a new advance, and they don't want to do that. They just want to make a little bit of money. I can't blame them really, but if I can never get the rights back while it's in print, I will then revise it, expand it, republish it either with somebody else or myself, what have you. So we'll see. That is in the works for the fantasy volume, which is out to print, and I'm working on this. It's just taking ages to get the rights back, but these are books which have really been books that I've enjoyed in the last sort of 23 years. And I'm not saying they're the best, I'm not saying they're for everybody. What I'm saying is they're books that I've enjoyed, and they're things you might want to try to open your head up a bit and get you looking at SF in a different way, moving beyond your expectations, not thinking about what you've seen on screens, not thinking what you've seen about the familiar, though there are some hard SF novels in here, but really just to look at the things which have turned me, as a mature science fiction reader who's been reading SF for 50 years, been selling books for 40 years, have really enjoyed. And you know, there's all sorts of things here, so I hope you'll check some of these things out. I have covered them on the channel before. It's going to be a pretty much whistle stop tour. I'm not going to talk about great length, so let's just dive into it. It's not a ranked list either, okay? But these are books that I've enjoyed, and I also feel they're books which have pushed forward the boundaries of SF, and I think that's really important. Evolutionary and revolutionary. I'm going to start with two old favourites of mine, authors I followed for a very long time, and they're up here on the podium. And with a apology to that Firefall by Peter Watts with Blindsight and Echopraxia, which I do think is good. Close but no cigar. There's a lot of coverage of this book already. You know, I'll talk with myself one day, but I don't think I've got a lot to add. Other people have said it is really interesting. I've read both twice. Very good. So do read Firefall as well. Blindsight you probably already know about. Anyway, Christopher Priest has been my favorite writer for a long time, my favorite living writer since the death of J.G. Ballard. Chris is now 80. He hasn't been well recently. Get well soon, Chris. I hope you're okay. And this is his novel The Adjacent, which is probably my favorite and the most SF-ish novel of his of this century. And Chris is a pioneer of the new wave and a master of the slipstream, and he's very ambiguous. Sometimes the novels feel like mainstream novels, but they actually aren't. And this is set in a near future which has become a Britain which has become Islamic, and there's been a terrorist atrocity which has wiped out hundreds of thousands of people and left an area in London just blank. And it's also about a stage magician a century ago, which Shades of the Prestige, which you probably know. There's World War II stuff in here, which harks back to his novel Separation. And it's dizzying stuff, and I don't want to say too much about it, but also if you liked Inverted World, Chris is somebody who really likes to pull the rug of reality from under your feet. And if you like Philip K. Dick, I wouldn't say that Chris is an English Philip K. Dick, but there are certain affinities. If you like PKD and you've never read Priest, you really must. So that's a great one. You might want to start with his early books, but that's my favourite book from him this century. But he's working on something else at the moment, which I think is going to be even more spectacular. Then, and I have mentioned this in a recent video, this is Zero History by William Gibson, the second of the Blue Ant Hubertus Bejond thematic trilogy. This isn't really SF at all, but Gibson, like Ballard, showed the whole thing about rubbing out the line between science fiction and general fiction, between the future and the present, and now we're living in the future. This is about a rock star who's down on her luck, and she goes to work for this guy called Hubertus Bejand, who employs cool hunters, people looking for the next trends which are going to take off online in the mass media. She's sent off to search for a particular type of denim called the Gabriel Hounds, and there are about 6 or 10 pairs of jeans made of this denim, and it doesn't have an easily identifiable mark. It's fascinating stuff. Sounds bonkers, I know, but it is the kind of weirdness that happens with trends in the real world. And Gibson, of course, comes out to cyberpunk, and he's pulling us into the future gradually and showing us that it's all around us. Brilliant. So a slightly ambiguous one there. As I say, this isn't a rank list, so I'm just going to go through these things as they come up in my pile. And I think next we'll go with, this is Painkillers by Simon Ings, and I'm quite aware it's very hard to see this cover. This is from the early part of the century. Simon Ings is a science writer, novelist. He's got a very chewy, crunchy literary style, lots of flavor. He doesn't always grab me, but I think fundamentally he's really good. Painkillers is near future SF, and it's about a man who has a young child which has this sort of cognitive issue, and he comes across this box which can solve this and many other problems. And it's got lots of sort of very sort of edgy, razor sharp moments of sex, violence, and it really is quite something. Again, it's near future, but it's a fantastic book and my favorite book by Simon. And he really does push the envelope, and it's sad really that he hasn't had more commercial success, because he's really good. He's been writing SF since the early 90s, and you know, wonderful, wonderful writer at his best. Lots of books out there, so give that one a try if you like good, strong literary SF with lots of sort of chamfers and burrs and sharp edges. That's very much the thing to go for. Painkillers, great stuff. Then who else have we got? Another one of my favorites, somebody who's really turned me on for the last sort of 10 years or so now, let's just pop that there, is the very wonderful Dave Hutchinson. This is Europe in Autumn. This is the first of the Fractured Europe books, of which there are 5 so far. This one, did it win the Arthur C. Clarke? It certainly was shortlisted. Yeah, shortlisted. I'm sure it won or not, I can't remember. And Dave is a little bit older than me. He's in his early 60s, didn't event with him once, fantastic guy. And he started writing SF in his teens, and he wrote about 4 collections of short stories which were published by a small publisher called Abelard. And then he went into journalism, didn't write SF for a long, long time. And he's typical of the sort of person who would have found it really hard to get published during the space opera renaissance, even though there is a space opera called Acadie, which you can get, which is a nice little novella, really good. And Dave's very witty and acerbic. You know, he's always got his sort of tongue in his cheek to a degree. And what Europe in Autumn does, it conflates the Le Carré-esque spy thriller with SF. And I say Le Carré, he's more like Len Dayton. He's sort of gritty, rather than overly sort of doomy in that way. But really, he's more like Mick Herron, because there is flashes of humor. And this is set in a near future where Europe has balkanized and cities and countries have broken up into smaller states. And that's rather like The City in the City by China Myville, which is my favorite book by China. And in this, there's a chap and he works in the basement of a restaurant, and you can feel the sweat and the salt and the heat, and he's just washing up and things. And he gets approached while he's serving the restaurant to become a courier for this strange organization who are smuggling secrets on paper across borders, because the internet is no longer secure. And there are things in this like computers made out of cardboard, stuff like that. And for quite a while, it doesn't feel like SF apart from the political situation. And then something happens, because there are more countries in Europe than everybody thought. And there's one in particular where people are crossing over borders, and it's from a very, very strange place indeed. I'm not going to say too much more. Brilliant. As I say, there's several sequels. The first 3 particularly are excellent. There's a TV series in production now from Studio Canal, and Canal, wonderful European studio. They make brilliant, brilliant stuff. As soon as I see Canal pop up at the beginning of a film or TV series, I think, right, I'm going to give this a go. And 8 times out of 10, it's spiffing stuff. So Europe in Autumn, really good. He has written other things as well. This is his sort of bread and butter, really, but it is really, really good. And as I say, I'm not going to tell you what the SF conceit is, because I want you to reader, and great, great fun, and wonderful characterization, really good stuff, and as I say, knockabout humor at times as well. Then a controversial book by a French writer. This is Submission by Michael, is it Houellebecq? I say Houellebecq because I'm Welsh, you know, I do like pronouncing this properly, but I'm Houellebecq, Houellebecq. And I've read several things by him, and this caused a huge furore in France. This is a near future book, and it's the first person narrative for an academic who teaches the writings of a writer called J.K. Huysmans, who's a really important French symbolist, naturalist, and decadent writer from the late 19th century in France, who went through this very interesting religious conversion. He was involved in devil worship and Satanism, and then he converted to Catholicism. And that has echoes in this book. And Submission is set in a near future where France has become an Islamic Republic. And Houellebecq is regarded as sort of right wing. He's certainly conservative. He's also very doomy. His characters are always having grim, joyless sex, and in that way he's rather like Barry Malzberg. And he does have a very dark view of life. But anybody who can write a book about H.P. Lovecraft, he wrote this great book about Lovecraft, a non-fiction book called Against the World, Against Life. I immediately got interested. One of the best titles ever. So if you like the dark stuff, and it is about how the society changes. Now you can say that's not science fiction, but it is, because if something like that were to happen, how would a minority group in any society, any sort of minority group, become powerful? Well, it would be through politics, it would be through the electorate. And, you know, we are seeing different groups coming into power across Europe and America, and the will of the people, that's democracy, that's how that would happen. And that's a scientifically explicable process. So it's soft science, it's politics, but it's nonetheless scientific. It's not magic, and it hasn't happened yet. The fact it hasn't happened yet, that it's a paradigm shift, that it's a novelty, a new thing, a novum, and something changes, that's the paradigm shift, and we see things differently. So it's very good. So it works on two levels, both as a sort of intertextual literary book, and as an SF novel, and as a mainstream literary novel as well. Very good indeed. I loved it. The sort of favourite book I've read by him. He's pretty famous, actually. So, and then on to a British writer who has consistently produced, I mean, he's produced about two dozen SF novels now, with one exception, this one two-book series. The rest are all singletons, and that's Adam Roberts. And Adam teaches at Royal Holloway University. He's an expert in sort of 18th and 19th century literature. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature, and he's a hardcore SF fan and SF writer. He's written a brilliant history of SF, which you should read, which has been updated recently. I need to get a new edition of that. And I've read a lot of his books, and this is The Thing itself. And the reason why this isn't in hardcover is because Gollancz never issued it in hardcover. Shame on them. I've got all of his other books in hardcover. I think there's only one other that was a paperback original, and that is Adam Robots, his short story collection. Now, The Thing itself is a philosophical science fiction novel. You see all these videos on YouTube, philosophical science fiction novels you must read. And as I said the other day, all great SF is philosophical by default, because it's about showing how the scientific method has changed our worldview. Brian Aldiss put it in Billion Year Spree, his history of SF. He said the science fiction was cast in the Gothic or post-Gothic mode, and it was an attempt for us to understand the universe in our so limited way of thinking, which is now scientific. So by default, all great science fiction is philosophical. And this is more specifically that way because this refers to Immanuel Kant. And first of all, you look and you think The Thing itself, you can see there's two chaps in the snow, and you immediately think of the John Carpenter film, The Thing, which was inspired by the Howard Hawks and Christian Nyberg film, The Thing from Another World from the 50s, which in turn was inspired by John W. Campbell's amazing short story, Who Goes There, which is fantastic. And the fantastic thing about seeing the Carpenter film is more akin to the 1937 short story than 1951 is. And you realize then how ahead of the curve Campbell was in terms of his thinking. Brilliant story. And this begins like The Thing. And it's about two guys, and they're in this Antarctic research station, two of them together. And they have different beliefs about things. And then something happens, which may be a close encounter of the third kind, but it may be something else. It may be the revelation that what they've actually come across is Kant's thing in itself, the naked lunch, the thing that's on the end of the fork, the reality of the universe. And it pursues them. And it's quite witty and knockabout, but it's quite serious as well. I don't want to say too much about it, because this thing they encounter is in some ways far worse than something that could tear you apart limb from limb and take on your identity. This is about identity in a different way. This is about existential angst and the meaning of things and the thing itself. And I absolutely loved it. Adam's done all sorts of books. He's done all sorts of things. His ambition really is to sort of do all the sort of common tropes, motifs, metaphors and symbols which have been the stuff of SF since H.G. Wells, and do sort of one book of a kind. And, you know, he does very serious books, he does very funny books. A good one to read, which John, the Sci-Fi Scavenger, my mate John, hi John, I hope you're watching, he picked up a copy of Stone the other day by Adam Roberts, which is probably his best early book, the third one, and that's a good one to look at as well. And I was tempted to bring that up, but I do love this so much, and I think it's a spectacularly good book, and I've sold loads of it in the last 5 years. It came out in 2018, so that's the thing itself. Somebody else I've mentioned on the channel a number of times, and I've interviewed her on the channel, and she's a lovely, wonderful writer, is Emma Newman. And this is After Atlas, the second of the Planetfall books. And the Planetfall books, there are four of them, and there's a short story collection which she self-published as an ebook. There's an interview with her on the channel. Do have a look at that. She's a great lady. She's a great fan. She's working on a utopian SF novel at the moment. This came out about just under 10 years ago, I would say. This is the second one. And the Planetfall books, they're like a mosaic. They overlap. And even though this is the second one, you could read it first and not miss out anything. And it's near future dystopia. There's been this situation where this religious cult have saved up some money and they built this spaceship and they've gone off to a planet where their leader says, you know, they will discover the reality and truth of life and the meaning of life and existence. And this is about somebody who's back on Earth. So this is sort of background stuff. And he's like an indentured slave. He's a detective. And he gets taken to a hotel in the southwest of England where he has to sort of investigate this locked room case. So there is a crime element, but there's more to it than that. And he has a personal assistant, a virtual personal assistant, you know, which is a common thing, like the avatar that pops up in the Blade Runner sequel, for example. And he basically has to pay off his debts by through being an indentured slave and doing this work as a detective. And the way it's rigged, he'll probably never pay it off, and he's got to do it, otherwise he won't, he can't even eat. But it's really, really something. And it contains the wonderful line, which I've quoted many times, and I quote it all the time, about the way the technology affects human lives, which is, with convenience, something is lost, and the dehumanization that comes from relying too much on tech. Great book. And Emma is somebody who came into SF from the traditional end. She was like a Star Trek fan, and she's in her late 40s, I think. Marvelous, really, really good, and she deserves your attention. The first one, Planetfall, was a New York Times bestseller, but she's lost the support of Gollancz, which is shocking. This is a Rock US first edition here. Brilliant, wonderful, wonderful book. There aren't many females on this list, because most women in genre fiction tend to write fantasy. That's not to say there aren't lots of female SF writers, but they very rarely grab me. So, and I do apologize for that, but this is subjective. And I do know that most of the viewers here are male. I mean, you know, I guess if I was young, good looking and 22, it would be a different story. But, you know, and I don't want to appear shallow and say, oh, you know, you're not watching me because I'm an old guy. But, you know, there is an element of that. So if you think, oh, he's an old guy, you know, I've been around a bit and know my stuff. So do listen. But great, great stuff. Read that. Fantastic. And good series overall. The first two books, particularly Planetfall, After Atlas, really good. What else do we have? Let's have a fiddle around with the podium here, give that a bit more exposure, because Emma's great. I must get in touch with her, actually. I haven't seen her for a while. And then we move on to a wonderful book, which I can't say enough good about. This is House of Rumour by Jake Arnott. And in paperback, it currently has one of the worst covers of any book ever. Jake's books have terrible covers. They are packaged as mainstream novels. What Jake is really good at, he's really good at writing about the 20th century in an historical sense, especially moments of countercultural or particular underground significance. And he's great at that. He's written some straight-ish historical novels as well, which are good. And he came to prominence in the late 90s with a book called The Long Firm, which really is a crime novel set in the 60s, very episodic and iconic, a great book. And it was a huge bestseller straight away. And he's a lovely guy. We've met a couple of times. I did an event with him once. I got him down to Bath from London, and we did an event for the book which followed this. But this blew me away. And when did this come out? House of Rumour. It came out around about 2014. Let's have a look at it. Let's see. 2012. And it's signed to me there, if you can see that. And basically, he's done some Doctor Who stuff as well. He did a Doctor Who novel fan. He's a Doctor Who fan. And this is like a secret history of the middle of the 20th century. It's about a young science fiction writer in the Golden Age who becomes besotted with a slightly older female science fiction writer in the Golden Age. It's about Jack Parsons, the Californian rocketry specialist who was involved with the occult with Aleister Crowley. Ian Fleming's in it, and it merges fact and fiction. And when I read this, I didn't know that some of the people in it were real. Like, I knew the Jack Parsons, and I read up on him, and it's very, very mysterious, and it refers to the writings of Ovid, the Roman poet, Metamorphoses as well. And it's really hard to describe, but it's a secret history of the middle of the 20th century, rocket pioneers, Nazism, the occult, what have you. And you know, you could argue maybe it isn't SF, but if it isn't SF, I don't know what it is. It's really groundbreaking and unique, and it gives you that feeling of wonder and strangeness that is inescapable. And it doesn't answer all the questions you wanted to answer, but it leaves you wanting more, and it's absolutely spellbinding, and he writes so beautifully. And Jake has this way of, he can write about a period of time that he wasn't even alive in and conjure it up with utter authenticity, and it never feels forced or tried. I do wish one day he would write a straight, undeniable genre SF novel, because I think he'd do a wonderful job. I don't know what he's doing at the moment, but great, great guy, really good. Love it. So that's House of Rumor. Something that I'm going to review on the channel, and the review might come up before this, is a book which I've just reread for the third, maybe the fourth time. As you notice, I'm making a hash of this. It's early in the morning, you know, and Smudge has been playing up as usual. Smudge, my cat, she's very naughty. And that's Never Let Me Go by Kazuo Ishiguro, which of course is a book about cloning. The C word comes up twice in this book, and not until late in it. And as I've just reread it, this is a first edition I bought recently. And when this came out, I'd read Remains of the Day, his famous Booker Prize winning book, which is a straight sort of social novel, very, very good. I am always suspicious of mainstream literary writers who feel they can suddenly write an SF novel. And you know, a lot of the time they've never read one, they think they're doing something that's original and it's not, and usually you're there. And I really, when I bought this, I thought about buying the hardcover limited edition in a slipcase. It was very beautiful, and I thought, no, I got a paperback instead. And I started reading it, and I had my critical knife out, and I wanted to slash it to pieces, but I loved it. And I was going to do a lecture on SF at a college in Swindon. This would have been 2006, 2007, when my book came out. And I didn't want to go, and I was getting paid for it, and I'd written the lecture, and it was in my head and everything. I just wanted to stay home to read this. So I was reading this on the way. I went on a train and a bus, I think. Or somebody drove me, but I couldn't put this down. It's fantastic. And I've reread it since, and my feelings have changed to a degree. I've read other things by Ishiguro since then, and what he's the master of is the very small things. But just to go on with the SF aspects of this, this is set in an alternate Britain where in the 1950s medical technology evolved enough for cloning to become a thing. And is set in what appears to be a small public school in the English countryside with children. They're like orphans. You think maybe they're orphans or something. And it's the first person narrative of a girl called Kathy, and it's about her relationship with her friends Tommy and Ruth. And basically what you learn throughout the novel is that they are going to become spare parts for people who need organ replacement. So it's kind of akin to Bug Jack Baron, say, by Norman Spinrad, that sort of thing. And it is really fantastic. But what's good about this, this is about what's outside the frame, and it's about what sort of society allows this kind of thing to go on. And that's the big question in this. As I say, there is going to be, or already has been, a review of this in detail, but I've read it 3-4 times. I think it's 4, and great stuff, and I loved it more. It is that thing that you could take it apart, because you think, well, if you can clone somebody, then, you know, can't you grow organs in a vat? But as I say in the review, we'll cover that. Marvellous stuff. Never Let Me Go. Then we have, what do we have next? We have the very wonderful J.G. Ballard. And this is Supercan, which came out early in the century and is regarded by most Ballard fans as his best book from the final tranche of 4. This is in my book 100 Must Read Science Fiction Novels. It's set in the very near future, or the present, on the Mediterranean near Cannes, the French city. Ballard used to go on holiday down there a lot, And there's this enclave called Eden Olympia, which is populated by technocrats, businessmen, people high up in the echelons of society, good jobs in, lots of money, and they've all got their offices there, and they've it's idyllic sort of life. But there is something dystopian lurking. There are sudden outbreaks of violence at night, and nobody can work out why. So there isn't any tech in this, but this is the thing with Ballard. Ballard changed SF because he showed us it was all around us. Inner space more important than outer space. So you've got this dystopian utopian thing going on, and there's a psychiatrist in this called Wilder Penrose, and he's this very ambiguous figure, and it has the feel of some of the great films, to say David Cronenberg, wonderful stuff, Supercan. It will challenge your expectations of where SF has been in the wake of Ballard and where it's going into the slipstream and infecting the mainstream with its diseased genes that will bring it all down. Wonderful stuff. So that's Supercan, really, really good. Somebody then who has received scant attention, really, and it's a great shame, as you see, I'm going surrounded by Bookshare, is James Smythe. And he wrote a series of space-based books, which were highly ambiguous, beginning with The Explorer. There are four of them, and I've only read the first one. And funny enough, in The Explorer, there's a spaceship called the Ishiguro, and this is the Machine. And the Machine is kind of a riff on the Frankenstein theme. And it's about a guy who goes off to a war. He's a soldier, and he comes back, and he's got kind of PTSD, and he's damaged. He's been damaged by something in this war, and it's about how his wife copes. And they have this machine delivered, which he can plug into, which will help him. And they live in this high-rise block near some cliffs by the seaside. It's a very strange setting. So there are reminiscences of things like high-rise. It reminded me, for some reason, it reminded me of George Turner's The Sea in Summer. I'm not sure why, possibly it was the high-rise thing. And it's quite black and dark. And it's also the sort of thing you like if you like D.G. Compton. It's about the morals of science. And I picked this up for, I read it in paperback, but I picked this up for 50p in a charity shop in Warminster or Westbury a few years ago. Desolate housing machine. And the machine is then sort of taken away. And the impact on this guy, and as I say, it's like a modern retelling or a contemporary retelling of Frankenstein. Really good. He hasn't had enough attention. He's a good little writer. He's written some teen books as well. He maybe is too subtle and sophisticated for the sort of average SF reader, maybe, but I urge you give him a try. If you want something space-based, try The Explorer. It is really good. I mean, Christopher Priest loved it. We chatted about it once, and yeah, it's good stuff. So James Smythe, worth checking out and underappreciated. Then we get a famous book, which everybody will have heard of, some of you will have read, and you know, it's not just here because I'm sort of throwing in a few sort of commercial things, and that's The Road by Cormac McCarthy. This is the UK first edition in Picador, and I just want to say briefly, I do like McCarthy. Sometimes I think he overwrites, sometimes he underwrites, sometimes he's just writing in between, and I would say Blood Meridian and this sort of things. And quite a famous book. I just want to say that of all the savage post-apocalyptic, post-nuclear books I've ever read, I think this is the best. And that's including genre classics going right back to the 50s. And I read this in one sitting. I could not put it down. I think A Boy and His Dog by Harlan Ellison is better because that has energy, verve, power. It's shorter and sharper because, of course, it's only a little novelette. But this has a kind of realism to it and a bleakness, which you cannot really get past. Wonderful, wonderful book. Loved it. So read it anyway. You kind of need to read it because it's in the contemporary canon now. And, you know, it's really, really great stuff. And one of my favorite books by him, probably my favorite book by him because it's the SF one. So there you go. Cormac McCarthy, The Road. Marvelous. Forget the film. The film's not bad, but it doesn't have that same feel, that same biblical feel that his writing has. Then let's look at a bit of more traditional hard SF. And this is a book that will surprise many because when this writer, Charles Stross, first appeared, he was getting published in Interzone short stories. And I used to find him really annoying. And again, Chris Priest said to me, oh, you know, he's like a sort of effervescent, irritating puppy. You know, it's too much all the time. And a friend of mine used to say, oh, I really like Charlie stuff. And I was like, argh! But I really came round to him and I read this. This came out about 2007 and it is fantastic, Accelerando. And the beauty of Accelerando is that I can only describe it as a post-humanist SF generational adventure that's combined with a sort of traditional structure of a sort of Victorian family saga. And it starts with this young guy who works in tech, and he has this encounter with a dominatrix, and I think it's in Amsterdam, it's certainly in Holland, and they have some kinky sort of goings on. But she gets pregnant, and that sort of spurs it off. There's lobsters in it, intelligent lobsters from outer space. There's all sorts of stuff, and it's episodic, so it's like a fix-up, but it's really like sort of having a little pack of tarot cards, and you fan them out, and each one is a different color, a different symbol, and it's really great. It's fantastic stuff, and I don't really go big on hard SF, but I love this. And the Guardian say on the back, like being trapped in the middle of an exploding ideas factory without a helmet. And everybody loved it, you know, and this is great. And he has been doing some series, and of course series are what bring in money, but his singletons, there's some good space opera type things as well, Singularity Sky, and the others in that series, Iron Sunrise, is it? They're good as well, I like those. But this is my favorite, great stuff. So the Outlaw Bookseller does occasionally dabble with the hard stuff, the real stuff, as a lot of you will say. It's great fun, it's very witty as well, and beautiful writing, really good. Well done, Charles. This is an excellent book, and if you haven't read it, and you know, you think you like your hard SF, you do your Peter Watts, you know, you do your Ian Banks, whatever, and you haven't read this, come on, it's good. Also in that vein is the very wonderful Ken MacLeod. And this is volume one of The Corporation Wars, Emergence. There are three of these, issued a few months apart in laminated boards hardcovers. In paperback, they like a one omnibus, and it's just not so nice. And these are fantastic. Hard SF, future conflict between sort of libertarian faction and a left-wing faction. A lot of us in virtual reality, virtual worlds, other planets. There are philosophical zombies in it. There's a lot of military action, great characterization, crackling dialogue, and marvelous, marvelous stuff. So it's political, but it's faster moving and harder and sharper than a lot of Ken's books. And I'm not big on sequences, but I love this. And this came out, I got in touch with Orbit, his publisher, and said, please can Ken come to Bath and we'll do an event. And we did, and it was fantastic. And he came down, and I was really sick, I had a really bad cold, I was coughing my guts, it was horrible. And I was there with lots of friends turned up, and local SF readers, and Tom Toner, my mate, the SF, to turn up. And by the end of the event, I was exhausted. And of course, with these things, it's not just presenting it and doing all that. You have to do all the work beforehand. You have to set things up. You've got to put the chairs away, what have you. It's hard physical work, you know. And I was just exhausted. And I said, you know, I can't come to the pub because, you know, I've got to come to work tomorrow and I'm wrecked. And of course, by then, it was like 10 o'clock at night. And all the guys went to the pub, and Ken was saying, oh, where's Steve? You know, I really wanted to buy him a whiskey and stuff. So maybe one day, Ken, maybe one day. Great, great stuff. I love it. Good, solid, hard SF, nice left-wing sensibilities, tons of ideas, beautifully expressed. Fantastic. Then we got an old favourite, and this is kind of here as an honourable mention. I do need to read this again, and he's still alive. He's very embittered, he's very black, he's very bleak, and you know, but I love him. I find him really bracing. This is On Account of Darkness by Barry N. Marsberg and Bill Pronzini, his occasional collaborator. This is a short story collection from early in the century. And I just wanted to show it to you because it's beautiful. I love Barry's writing. He just produces the odd short story, you know, lots of essays. He hasn't done a novel for a long time. There's been a big reissue program with Stark House of his mainstream novels, some of which are quite sexy, of his crime novels, some of which are quite sort of, you know, throwaway. There's the Lone Wolf series. I've shown them on the channel. And my friend James Reith, the novelist, has been involved with Anti-Oedipus Press in the USA in reissuing his Beyond Apollo trilogy, which is fantastic. And you know, these are great stories. I don't want to say any more about it, largely because I haven't read it for a long time, but I loved it when I did, and fantastic stuff. So if you want to see what somebody who grew up in the 50s and who is now an embittered old guy who is a literary genius and deserves our fealty and respect writes in short story forms this century, that's the one to go for. Barry, we salute you. You are the man. Great stuff. Might be quite hard to get. I don't know if there's ever been a paperback, but you know, if you can't get this, get one of Barry's books. Get one of the ones from the 20th century, from the 70s or the 60s. Brilliant stuff. Really lovely. What else do we have? Oh yes, this is a real favourite, and no contemporary SF reader should be without this. This is Remainder by Tom McCarthy, which was first published around about 2005, 2006 in a limited edition by a French publisher and then was snapped up by a UK publisher. This is his first novel. He's written four or five. Very interesting guy. None of his other books have really worked for me. I've got one I haven't read yet. And this sort of came out of nowhere. There has been a film of it, which isn't really that great, even though I know somebody who's in it. And what Remainder's about? Remainder is about a chap who is hit on the head by a piece of tech that falls from the sky. Now, the fact that it's a piece of tech is important. Being hit on the head by something that falls from the sky, you know, is a thing and it's going to affect you. But this is a bit of tech, and this is why it's a science fiction novel. And he wakes up in hospital. He's been in a coma and his memory's been affected, but he's got compensation from the government body or firm who are responsible for this piece of tech. And we never learn what it is, but it's done something to his mind. It's not just a blow on the head. The tech has done something. And he develops strange obsessions with recreating memories or instances or scenes which possibly never ever happened. And as I say, he gets some compensation. He gets about 8 million quid and he spends this money. He buys somewhere to live and then he goes about reenacting and constructing these scenes which are in his head, which may be memories, they may be fantasies. It's hard to tell. And it goes off at a wild tangent. And it's this, it does the sort of thing that I want SF to do. You can't tell what's going to happen, but it is on a very solid basis. You know, the guy's neurodivergent, but in a very interesting way. And it goes off on a tangent and things start to slip out of control. And it's absolutely fantastic. This really is one of the best novels I've read this century. And if I, this were a rank list, this could be number one. It's very, very high up there. Remainder by Tom McCarthy. Unmissable. Next, another curveball, a short story collection, sort of privately published, fairly limited edition, no jacket as you see. And is it a short story collection? I would say they're linked. This is The Quiet Man by John Fox, who is an electronic music artist. And he lives in Bath some of the time these days. I see him around and we're chums. We catch him now and again. I've been a fan of his work since the 1970s. He used to front a band called Ultravox in the early days before they became famous. And he wrote this book over many, many years. And it's a sort of English catastrophe novel situation. You imagine a future where London has become overgrown, depopulated. There's nobody there but this one man. And he's walking around the city and plants are overtaking everything. It's very sort of Ballardian, very Richard Jefferies. And he wanders around the city going into old cinemas, old buildings, what have you. But this also flashes back to his former life as an ordinary office worker in the city. And it's very, very beautiful. And it's a book which you shouldn't read cover to cover from start to end. You should just pick it up now and again, because it's like a selection of vignettes. And it is about the beauty of nature. It refers back to the whole tradition of the English catastrophe novel, where secretly we psychologically wish for the country to be empty because we hate crowds and we like open space. And we love the idea of surviving in a depopulated, rural, agrarian Britain, but still to enjoy the pleasures of the city. And it's very, very beautiful. And if you can get it, do is great stuff. I don't imagine there'll ever be a mass market edition. And again, it's a fascinating one. Fox is massively influenced by Ballard. He's read Christopher Priest. He used to do covers for science fiction books back in the 70s. He did lots of covers for vintage books in the late 80s and 90s because he's a visual artist as well as a musical artist. And The Quiet Man, fantastic stuff. Then, back into more hardcore skiffy, and somebody who I'm very fond of. There is an interview with him on the channel, and that's Chris Beckett. And I could have picked any number of his books, so I like them all. They're all great. This is the one I would say for beginners to start with, and this is The Holy Machine. And this is the Cosmos Wildside edition, which is out of print now, and it's a Corvus paperback. And Chris always says to me that this is his favorite cover, and I like it as well. There wasn't really nice lay format. And The Holy Machine is my go-to book when somebody says they want to read about AI or robots. I say, no, no, don't read that, read this. And this is set in a future Europe, a future world where there's only one secular state in Europe, and it's down in the south of Europe. And It's about a young chap who grows up in this secular state, but he wants to travel to other countries to see what they're like. He wants to sort of go and tour them and see what they're like. And he decides to take his sex robot with him. And this has unintended consequences, because when his sex robot goes with him, things happen and it becomes, well, I'm not going to tell you. It's hard-edged, it's beautifully written, it's fairly fleet and sharp. And it's quite shocking at times, but it has got real empathy and love in it. And he's a lovely guy. And Chris has done some classic world-building things. There's the Dark Eden trilogy, which was a big award winner, which is an interesting sort of pantropy colonization type thing. And there are books which are very political, like America City and Two Tribes, which speculate on populism in the future and the social media and how social media affects politics. There are very surrealistic jungle-based things like Beneath the World of Sea, which is fantastic, and the utterly indefinable Tomorrow, all of which are good. And then there's Marcher, which is a wonderful book set in Bristol, only scant 10-15 miles from here, which is about an immigration officer who has to deal with immigrants coming from another dimension. And it's a fantastic book. And this is really great. Holy Machine. Never mind all the other AI and robot books out there from this century. This is the one. And Chris Beckett, fantastic English SF writer who does not get enough attention. If you watch the recent video I did of the Reports in the Deep End J.G. Ballard Memorial Tribute Anthology multi-signing, Chris is in that. And there's an interview on the channel from round about January this year as well. Another great friend of mine, who I am making no apologies about promoting here, is the sublime Nina Allen. Now, Nina is in her mid-50s. She's been writing for quite some time. Lots of short stories and things under her belt, lots of novels. She can write pretty much anything. Her new book this year is called Conquest. I was discussing it the other day with Stark Holborn, and Stark, you know, she loved it, but how it isn't SF and it's not. This one is. This is The Silver Wind. Usually when people say to me, what's your favourite Nina Allen book, I say The Rift. I decided to go with The Silver Wind this time, and this is the first edition. This has now been expanded and revised in paperback by, is it Titan? I think it's Titan or Solaris. And it's a time travel thing. And again, it's a bit of a fix-up. There's these episodic sort of novellas, and they're about time travel, and it's very British and very beautiful. And I don't really want to go into the plot very much, so I don't want to give anything away. And it works through watches and clocks, so it's got this slightly gothic sort of element. So it's the idea of watches and clocks and time machines, but actual time machines. And really, really good. Probably my favourite time travel novel for a long, long time, certainly this century. And Nina writes really, really beautifully. Something she's good at is not being overly clear about what she's getting at. You have to work it out. You have to think about it. And she likes to imply lots of things. She implies lots of things rather than boldly states them. And that doesn't always work in her favor as a novelist, but sometimes it does. And the wonderful texture of her prose, and she's a very, very wise lady and somebody who really is interested in pushing the envelope. So this is probably one of her two most SF-ish books. The Rift, as I say, is brilliant. The Rift is about two sisters. One goes missing for years, suddenly reappears in another sister's life, and she claims she's been on another planet, or has she? So that's The Silver Wind, Nina Allen. As I say, there's an expanded edition out now. I'm very fond of this brief one. I think it works very, very well. So if you can get that one as well, please do. Then, another old favourite of mine, somebody else who's been interviewed on the channel. You see a theme emerging here. I tend to only interview writers I really like, and a lot of them are people I've got to know personally over the years. And this, is it actually SF? It's a hard one to say. You could say it's fantasy. I'm going to say it's SF because it's ambiguous, like all his best work. And this is The Sunken Land Begins to Rise Again by M. John Harrison. Now, M. John was a figure who emerged in the English New Wave, and he's written space operas like The Centauri Device, which is a Gollancz masterwork, The Light Trilogy, which Ian M. Banks said was brilliant, but it baffled a lot of people, a post-Holocaust narrative called The Committed Men, short stories, weird fiction. There's a mainstream novel called Climbers, which was in a video I did recently about associational SF. And there's this, his most recent novel, which won the Goldsmiths Prize. And the Goldsmiths Prize is given for books which expand the boundaries of fiction, and boy, Mike does that. If you like Gene Wolfe, you'd like him. If you like anything really well written, you'd like him. If you like Robert McFarlane, you'd like him. And Mike's a wonderful prose stylist, amazing writer, and it's been my absolute delight to host events with him, and known him for a long time. Again, interview on the channel, as I say. And this is set in London. It's about two people who are middle-aged, and they've recently come out of unhappy sort of personal situations, and they're starting to get together, and they're very tentative about it. And there's a lot of action set around canal boats, rivers, and bodies of water, because there's something emerging. There's something coming out of this water, even when it's only a shallow pond that is formed after rainfall on a lawn. And as Nina Allen said to me about this, she said, this book is wild. You just want to scream at them. There are fish people. So... So there's more to it than that. There's lots of mentions of Charles Kingsley's The Water Babies as well. And in a way, it's almost like the Lovecraft story, The Shadow of Innsmouth. There's hints of that as well. But this is not pulp. This is literature, but with an awareness of pulp. Richard Morgan, author of Altered Carbon, which is in 100 Must-Read Science Fiction Novels, plug, plug, plug. And Altered Carbon came through with a big smash. And this is Market Forces, which was originally written as a screen treatment for a film which never got made. And Richard turned it into a singleton instead. And this is my favourite book by him. I mean, I like his more trad SF. This is near future dystopian Europe about a young man who has left-wing sensibilities, but he realises the world is going to hell in a handbasket, and he's got to make some money, because only people with money will survive the impending climate collapse and the dreadful things that are happening all over the world. And he has conflicts with his father about this, who's a solid socialist figure. And he gets involved with this company which does conflict investment. They're a kind of investment company, and they put money into different geopolitical situations around the world with the hope of sparking wars and investing and almost gambling on wars coming forward. So it's incredibly immoral, and it's really just critique the military industrial complex, the way that governments are increasingly meaningless. And because Gibson started doing this in New Romancer and the Sprawl books a long time before in the Sprawl stories. And it really is quite something. It has a strange Mad Max type element in it, where there are corporate duels between people in fast cars. And when people say, what's it like? Because I recommend it a lot of work. I say it's Mad Men meets Mad Max. So it's sharp suits, you know, up against, you know, razor sharp wheels and what have you, which sounds bizarre, but it works really well. But that's only a small part of the book. Market Forces, I love that title because that's an important thing. What we get to read in SF, what gets published, either way, self-published or published by mainstream publishers, is down to market forces. The ease of getting an unusual book from a small press is down to market forces. So it is one of those things. And really, really good. He's got a very decent left-wing sensibility. You don't have to be left-wing to like all these books. You can be right-wing. The point is, it's all about the ideas. SF is about ideas. And I do like political speculation on either side. And this is where sometimes I don't mind reading Heinlein, because even though I don't share a lot of his libertarian views, you know, it is interesting to speculate on what might happen in a society like, say, Starship Troopers, where you can only have political power if you've served the state. That's quite an interesting idea. And Market Forces is kind of flips that on its head, as it were. And this is really good. And it's probably his least known book. I think it's his finest. I do like him. He does singletons. He did a fantasy trilogy, which was quite sort of grim dark, if you like, and stepped outside the box a bit. I love Altered Carbon. I think it's a book with a decent sense of despair. The two sequels seem kind of unnecessary, but you know how it is. And the TV series didn't shy away from the sex and violence, it has to be said. But, you know, you only want so much of this sort of thing. That's good. Shame It Never Gone Away. It would have been an interesting film. We're on the home stretch now. And then somebody who will be a familiar name to virtually everybody who reads the sort of more popular SF that's been out there in the last sort of 10-15 years, and that's the very wonderful Adrian Tchaikovsky, and this is Dogs of War. What amazes me continually about this book is that people don't seem to know it exists. Everybody reads Children of Time. Everybody reads it, and they say, I love Adrian Tchaikovsky, and I say, if you read Dogs of War, and they say, what? It's like, come on guys, the internet is there. Look it up, you know, look him up, see what else there is. Dogs of War is, I think, his best written book. It's his most muscular. It's got the sort of best sort of moral sort of side in it. It's got good characterization. It has precursors in the form of Ellison's Boy and His Dog, Grant Morrison's wonderful graphic novel, We Three. And it's set in a future where animals and people have been gene spliced to create these kind of super soldier figures. And the focus in this one is like a dog man. And he works for a sort of horrible sort of arms dealer type person. And there's shades of the Island of Dr. Moreau as well, of course, of vivisection and what have you. And there's a intelligent bear, there's a lizard which is massive called Dragon, and there's a swarm of bees which have been engineered as well. This is like a nanotech type thing, absolutely brilliant. And it's really, really hard-edged, doesn't pull any punches, and it's not too long, it's not too short. It's a great adventure story. There's comments in there on contemporary politics, and you know, and it really burns. It's like sort of an acid seeping through metal, and it all sort of steams upward. And I love this. I thought it was great. And I think Adrian's done some good stuff, but he writes an awful lot and too fast sometimes. There is a sequel called Bearhead, which isn't bad, but wasn't really necessary. This was where it was all at. And Dogs of War, easily one of the best traditional SF novels of the century. I do wish he would aspire to write less and write as well as this. So there's more to Adrian than Children of Time. Try Dogs of War. Okay, because it's his best. That's what I say. Then we move on to a female writer, and we're nearly there now, and we're getting a bit more international now. And this is Little Eyes by Samantha Schweblin. And where is Samantha from? I can't remember. She, interesting background. She, let's see, from Buenos Aires, so she's Argentinian. She lives in Berlin. And this is Little Eyes, with all these little pandas on the cover, as you see. And I reviewed this back in the early days of the channel, and it'll be going a few months. And I love this. And she's written, I think, one other novel, a short story collection. I do want to read more by her. And Little Eyes is about a kind of internet trend. There are these little sort of creatures, and they're little furry sort of guys. What are they called? I can't think what they're called. Anyway, there's these little teddy bear type creatures, and they're sort of cutesy and Japanese looking. They've got a Japanese type name. And you buy one, and it has a camera in it, and whatever it can see, it films live and streams live. So it'll stream your life out to another person on the other side of the globe. And it's all done randomly and at chance. It's all random, so you don't know who's watching, who you are. And they've got a kind of life of their own, and they can toot along the streets on their own. And it begins with this really unpleasant sort of erotic scene between three women, which is very sort of American Psycho-ish, and you think, oh, this is quite unpleasant. But it settles down, and it moves to a number of characters who are working on these things. They're called Tamagotchis, but it's something like that, and it doesn't say in the jacket. It's a while since I've read it, so I do apologize. And you just see how once a piece of tech is released into society, how that's it. It's there for life. It's there forever. Never entirely goes away, or the concept never goes away. And it moves through these different things. And you think of the things we've seen on social media, the internet, since it became a big thing about 20 odd years ago. And, you know, nobody imagined that a lot of these things are catching. Think of social media, think of YouTube, you think of all sorts of stuff, how they've changed our consciousness. And I found this very compelling. And the beauty of it is that it doesn't really have a resolution. So it's like the way the tech impacts on the real world. And you see some devastating consequences come from for individuals in this, in terms of their personal feelings, or what happens to them physically, but it doesn't resolve. It doesn't resolve. And that's the way the tech is in the real world. Maybe it will resolve eventually with the end of the world, oh God. But the thing is, it just shows you how once tech is unleashed, once it's out of Pandora's box, that's it, and you've just got to go with it, you know. So Little Eyes, Samantha Schweblin, really, really good. Publishes a mainstream novel, so if you go to your bookshop, you will not find it probably in the SF section. I think it's excellent, and it should have been a bigger bestseller than it was. I'm going to finish off with another book from overseas. This is a French book called The Anomaly by Herve Letellier, and it's got this very bland cover, which makes it look like a mainstream thriller. And the publishers clearly didn't know what to do with it. They didn't know how to package it. They thought, oh, we can't make it like a genre SF novel, because it won the Prix Goncourt, which is a very prestigious French literary prize. The Anomaly is about a plane that takes off, flies to its destination, which is in the USA, and lands. And then a few months later, a duplicate of that plane and all the people on board lands as well. And it's very, very interesting concept. What the book does, it doesn't begin with that. It does some character establishment first, But you think, oh, it's a bit of a cop-out. But it's not, because the way it does it, the very first character, it immediately drops you into what may appear to be a thriller or crime-type scenario. And you can see a bibliographer reading a bit and saying, oh, yeah, this is a crime novel. But it's not. It's an SF novel, because this duplication of this plane and these people, how the authorities deal with it and how the people themselves deal with it, is fascinating stuff. And really, really, really good. And it didn't do particularly well in the UK. And I think, had it been actually published and packaged as a science fiction novel, it would have done a lot better. So I think really it's missed this audience, but the Prix Goncourt, important French literary prize. And Herve Le Tellier was a member of a group called Oulipo. And Oulipo were this sort of cadre of guys who experimented with language. I mean, the most famous Oulipo book is a book called A Void by a guy called Georges Perec. And A Void is a novel that doesn't have the letter E in it anywhere. Imagine that. And of course, it was written in French, because most of them are French. And it had to be translated from French without the letter E into English without using the letter E. And it's one of the strangest reading experiences you can ever imagine. So he's from that school. And the ending of this, I'm still puzzling about it now, but I like that because I don't want anything too neat. So you want things neat, forget it. Neat is not where it's at. The way that SF wakes us up, throws the bucket of water in our face, this is sort of like challenging stuff. So those are 25 SF novels and collections I've enjoyed this decade. They're the sort of things that I would look at to put in my book, 100 Must Read Science Fiction Novels, plug again, if I were ever to get the chance to expand it. And a lot of some of these things you will have read, and this authorship you know of, you will have read, you might have read different books by them. But the point is that SF isn't just genre SF. There's other things out there. And to many, this would be a radical list. I haven't gone out my way to be radical. This is just the stuff that has turned me on. And, you know, I'm not the sort of guy who reads the routine stuff, because I've read lots of that. And if I'm going to read sort of space operas and things like that, I normally go back to the Golden Age and beyond. And I'm not averse to those things entirely, don't get me wrong. But, you know, first thought, best thought, pioneers usually did it best because the ideas were fresher and newer. So there you go. So that's 25 21st century science fiction novels that you may enjoy. Hope you liked it. Comment, like, subscribe, all that stuff. Super thanks. And I'd better go and get the cat back now because she's playing up something wicked. Bye for now.